Hi there. Welcome to Thursdays at Home, a weekly live streamed hour of performances, readings, and more from IU students, faculty, and staff, brought to you by the IU Arts and Humanities Council. My name is Anna Groover, and I'm a council intern and your host this evening. The arts and humanities are more vital than ever in this moment. In that spirit, it's a great time to come together and celebrate all that the creative visionaries of IU have to offer. So sit back and get cozy, because we've got a rockstar IU lineup for you this evening. Last week, we had some technical difficulties during this live stream, so two of last week's guests have graciously and triumphantly returned, author and history professor Sarah Knott and poet and English professor Ross Gay. Later in the evening, we'll hear from Jacob student and keyboardist Garrett Spoelhof and theater professor and Broadway veteran Roland Richard. Let's get started. Our first guest is Professor Sarah Knott, an associate professor of history, a fellow at the Kinsey Institute, and an affiliate faculty member of the Gender Studies program at IU. She will be sharing a passage from her most recent book, Mother is a Verb, an acclaimed blend of history and anecdote that tells a story of motherhood throughout the ages. Welcome, Sarah.
So greetings, everybody. Hello from my home here in Bloomington, just south of campus. It's a really beautiful evening here. I can hear my children's voices floating up from the yard. I have donned a jacket that I often like to wear when I'm doing a reading. So welcome to this virtual event. So the request to do a reading tonight sent me back to my recent book, Mother is a Verb, which came out last year. And as Anna said, the book is part memoir and part history about having a child, specifically having a new child. And that topic turns out to be more apt, really, than I quite expected. One shared dimension, I think, of the crisis that we're all living through is our experience of the warping of time, right? The throwing off of our usual schedules, the onrush of news, the strange passing feeling of anxiety or boredom or worry. All our timelines are off. And one of this book's themes, too, is time, how the sudden arrival of an infant, too, warps time in its own way, fragments it. How the arrival of a new infant makes us inhabit time differently than we did before. So I thought I would open then with some short extracts from a chapter called Time Interrupted. This is chapter 12, and we enter the story with a 3 or 4 month old baby at hand. And actually it's April, just as it is for all of us right now. Think of the day in four parts. My friend Mavanwi advises during a phone call. Morning, afternoon, evening, night. That sounds familiar enough, except that it's not. The point is that each part can be wildly different. The baby can be content one moment and miserable the next. The good bits are lived in swinging buoyancy. The bad bits are staccato chaos. There's rhythm and there's interruption. Morning, afternoon, evening, night. These are the rhythms of the daily round. The halting, the interruption constitutes my new everyday. I am mid-thought, mid-sentence, mid-task, and then I am stopped. Morning, afternoon, evening, night. Interruption comes into view wherever the archive gets closest to mothering. Shimmy near, pause softly if you can. In the present, the essayist Lisa Baratza reckons the interruptions to be so relentless and so formative that she proposes them as the main condition of maternity. Place her before a baby and a mother, and she sees a scene of interruption. Now, there's one such history of interruption to be found among the reams of late 18th and 19th century letters. Broken off letters, short letters, impoverished letters, unwritten letters. When educated women took to letter writing in the 18th century, mothers' attempts to keep up with their correspondence often told about interruption. Jane Scrimshire was stopped by 1,000 petty riens that happen in families, 1,000 little nothings, fragmented time. Bessie Ramsden started a letter that was finished by her husband William. Mrs. Dar was called up to the nursery, he added in his own handwriting, or she would not have left off so abruptly. This kind of interruption is being summoned by the present, the here and now, with a past left behind and a future postponed. In later years, Bessie kept reaching ahead to the chance of concentrating, of being absorbed in a singular task. If I do take a pen, I always meet with some interruption, she writes. And then later, as I've laid by my cradle, as I put my cradle aside, her infants having grown, I shall have more time. But in another letter, my little folks are now pestering me for their tea, so shall conclude. Or there's Anne Livingston in Philadelphia in 1783. My child calls for my assistance, she penned. Therefore, I must defer writing what I intended for the evening. Or there's Louisa Wiley Boyson of 1878, Indiana. And Bloomington folks will know that as someone who resided in the Wiley House Museum, only a few hundred yards, in fact, from where I'm living. So Louisa Wiley Boyson of 1878, Indiana, she writes, as I have to be continually running after baby, I will use a lead pencil. Now, this was considered inappropriate for a letter. That is more convenient. Or there's Boyson's relative in the same house 3 years earlier. Baby is stirring, so I must. To write a letter at all, or to start to write a letter, already means that such a woman is literate, already means that there's most likely some fragment of time that she called her own. Probably it means that there's a servant on hand. These women were all members of the 18th century and 19th century employing class. Rarely do they write about what happened at the cradle or when they went upstairs. That was apparently too mundane, too much of a given to share with their correspondents. But in the interruptions themselves, there's new interruptions. In the interruptions themselves, they hint at a feature of mothering. But first, I notice only what those writers omitted, the silences that frustrate my curiosity. But now I notice the stutter step of the downing of the quill and the drying out of the ink in its stand, the misuse of a pencil, the halt to whatever task was at hand or thought was in composition. Afternoon, evening, night, morning. Sometimes a mother with her hands full is visited by an interviewer. In the early 1970s, first mothers with babies of a few months in age spoke to a research officer from the University of London. The academic was sympathetic, a feminist, a former housewife, a mother herself, and the women interviewees opened up. Sandy Wright had been a secretary, and now she said, all the time I'm thinking, I'm going about doing bits of housework and thinking, am I going to have time to do this before she wakes up? You know, because if she does cry, there isn't anyone else who can go and see to her. You've got to stop what you're doing. Or there was the former civil servant, Lily Mitchell. I don't do half of what I'd like to do at all, she said. People say you're at home all day, but I don't start the things. If it's something I really want to get stuck into, I don't start it. And then after I find I would have got it done, I think I should have started it. Interruption 1970s style was described in relation to housework and a baby's naps. These women were home alone. Housework was a woman's task, and a baby in a crib was laid down and picked up. Lily Mitchell, that former civil servant, she reckoned it's the way it's been going on for years. The confiding, commonplace tone of this reporting suggests that there were more remarks like this, that this experience of maternal interruption was entirely usual. And that's the implication too of Lily's weary sense of powerlessness, right? But that's how it's always been. Ah, the baby just woke up. Some days still, I'm unprepared for the joy of his presence, the prone content of our intimacy. He's finding his hands. It's as if cognition is traveling down his body. First arrived the smile. Now hands can be pressed into his mouth, my mouth. They slide and pull at the interior of my lips. So those are some thoughts about how a person's sense of time shifts radically on the sudden arrival of a newborn, right? The replacement of one way of inhabiting time with another. If you've just joined us, my name is Sarah Knott, and I am reading from Mother is a Verb, an Unconventional History. So reading these extracts today, of course, the other point that I notice is the underlying stuck at homeness of this contemporary experience and the experience of these 17th and 18th century letter writing women and of those women from the 1970s. Now, we're all living under a stay-at-home order. Many of us are confined for a great deal of the day in our homes and gardens. So I thought my last extract would actually take us imaginatively into the wider world outside and sort of remind us, if you like, of other possibilities, other pasts and other futures when we will be together again. So here's a final extract. Before the baby, my daily round had been coordinated with the rhythm of academic working life. Teaching, meeting, writing deadline, weekday, weekend, semester. Kay's disappearances and reappearances, Kay here being my partner. Kay's disappearances and reappearances repeat that coordination, But for now, I'm living within morning, afternoon, evening, night. There's a group of new parents I encounter at a community centre, most Tuesday and Thursday mornings. The talk at the centre is of 3 or 4 hour schedules or of breastfeeding on demand. Some are fretting about the return to work, US law allowing for only 6 weeks of leave. Our tone veers from mutual comfort to stark shock. We vent exaggeratedly about being stuck at home, about not being able to finish a meal, to hold a thought in mind, to speak to the end of a sentence. It's a long way from Thursday afternoon to Tuesday morning. Each Thursday, I throw the ship's anchor ahead, trying to pull the baby and me into next week. Friday afternoon, Kay is cycling down the road, and any moment now, he will arrive. My diary on this day reads, Kay came with me so I could get my hair cut. There's lost pleasures there. Kay came with me so I could get a haircut. He walked the baby about, showing him the cards and clouds passing for 3/4 of an hour. The entry's final comment documents this is the longest time the baby and I have been apart since he arrived more than 3 months earlier. As I walk with the baby up the road, I think of where the archives don't get so close to mothering, but where they offer an alternate account to the constancy of maternal interruption, an apparent alternative to the rhythm of being absorbed and being interrupted. Contemporary Native American storytelling suggests, at least indirectly, a story in contrast. So let's listen for a moment to Maria Campbell, a Saskatchewan storyteller. Like many women of my generation, Maria Campbell observed, I grew up with stories, lots of them, and all kinds, sacred stories, family histories, riddles. But it was the stories about the women I loved best, she said. The storyteller from Gabriel's Crossing, Saskatchewan, described Monday wash days in her mid-20th century Métis community. Laundering was collective. Maybe 8 or 10 wagons of us would go to this big pit about half a mile up the road. Huge cast iron pots of water were heated on fires. Children swam in their underwear in clean water. The lunch, the Sunday supper warmed over. And when a woman had a baby, she didn't take part in the heavy scrubbing, but handed over her laundry and tended to the cooking instead. She was surrounded by people. These communal habits ended with the arrival of gas washing machines. But in the decades immediately before, as Campbell told it, Métis women most often labored communally, not in solitude. For these women, mothering's interruptions had none of the isolation, the 9-foot square kitchen autonomy that so marked the broken daily round of their contemporaries in nuclear households. Mothering has not always been isolating and isolated. This was not the natural and age-old state of affairs. Domestic solitude was distinctive and far from inevitable. So this comes from my stay-at-home remoteness to yours. It's been a real pleasure to join in this virtual event, and I'm looking forward to hearing everybody else.
Thanks so much for that delightful reading, Sarah. I love the cadence of your writing. If you're just tuning in, this is Thursdays at Home. For more performances, virtual gallery tours, and other great online content from the Arts and Humanities Council and our friends across campus, check out the link in the comments to visit the virtual ANH page on our website. Our next guest is Garrett Spoelhof. Garrett is a sophomore studying in the Jacobs School of Music and the keyboardist for Bloomington-based band Secret Mezzanine. Garrett will be performing some songs on the keyboard for our listening pleasure. Take it away, Garrett. Thank you.
Cool. So, thank you so much to everybody involved with this. This has been really cool, and I'm happy to be here. Like Anna said, my name is Garrett Spoelhof. I go to school at IU, at the Jacobs School of Music, and I'm part of a band, Secret Mezzanine, and we play around the area. And this is a really great thing that the Arts and Humanities Council is doing to kind of, maybe it's normal, maybe it's not, but keep some semblance of our everyday lives during whatever's going on here. So that was a tune by Britney Spears, just a great song. Hit Me Baby One More Time. You know, the news, every day we look at the news and we wonder if it could get any worse, and then the next day they hit us one more time. And so I thought that might be a fitting song, because, you know, they hit her one more time and she wrote a great song about it, so maybe we can come up with something good too. So next up, like I mentioned, I'm in a band, Secret Mezzanine, and so I'm going to play one of our songs off of our last EP. It's the title track. So this is Thought of Man. Thank you. This is really surreal, performing through a Facebook live with no audience. This is very strange. But I hope that you're enjoying it, despite the strangeness. I'm having a great time playing for you guys. And my time is about up. I've got one more song. Stick around. There's great presenters throughout this whole event, and keep tuning in. Thursdays at Home, the Arts and Humanities Council. I've been Garrett Spoelhof. Thanks.
Thank you, Garrett. That was so lovely. If you're just tuning in, this is Thursdays at Home. Welcome. Keep an eye on our Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram feeds every Friday for What a Week, a curated digest of the coolest online content from around IU Bloomington. Join us here on our Facebook page every Tuesday evening for quarantine conversations as Indiana University faculty members confront COVID-19 from a wide range of disciplinary perspectives in the arts and humanities. Our next quarantine conversation is Tuesday, April 21st at 8 p.m., and we'll cover the topic, suffering and solitude. Check out the link in the comments for more info. Our next guest of the evening is Professor Richard Roland. Richard is an assistant professor in IU's theater, drama, and contemporary dance department and heads the BFA musical theater program. He's a fourth generation performer and a third generation Broadway veteran, having appeared on Broadway in Thoroughly Modern Millie, The Scarlet Pimpernel, and Follies, and in the national tours of Titanic and Millie. Tonight, he'll be sharing some show tunes with us. The floor is yours, Richard.
Thanks, Anna. First of all, Garrett, that was amazing. Thank you. That was really beautiful. Hello, everybody from South Washington Street here in Bloomington. I'm wearing my t-shirt. Couldn't find my IUNT t-shirt tonight, of course, so I'm just going to represent Bloomington as a whole. You know, when they asked me to come and do something on here, I had no idea what to do. I haven't performed in quite a long time, but I figure all bets are off now that we're all in quarantine, so I'm going to put my money where my mouth is and drag out my old audition book. So this is me back in the day when I didn't have facial hair. That's because I didn't have cheeks and jowls then either. And also, that's so old that it's a black and white photo. But this is my audition book. This is what I used to get jobs with, or not get jobs with, depending upon how well I did that day. So I went through it a couple days ago and figured I'd pull some cuts out and show everybody what I used to do. Great. That's where we're starting. So this first tune, this tune actually used to get me a lot of callbacks and a lot of second chances, second song responses. Because it's just kind of fun and quirky, and it's an old Cole Porter tune from a musical called The New Yorkers. I tailored it a little bit to my specific needs for the audition room, but this is I'm Getting Myself Ready for You by Cole Porter. Gee, I'm lucky to get you here. What a wonderful treat. Just look over the menu, dear, and see what you'll have to eat. If I say I'll have nothing, dear, please don't think me extreme. 'Cause since we've met, I'm so upset. I've gone on a regime. I've cut out eggs and turkey legs with corned beef hash, I'm all through. 'Cause I'm getting myself ready for you. I'll never stoop to onion soup and pork and beans are taboo. 'Cause I'm getting myself ready for you. To be sure I'm being worthy of you, dear, in every way, I'm building a perfect physique. And besides which, I want you to holler hooray when first you see me in my soda speak. If you still feel I need a meal, I'll risk an olive or two. But I'm getting myself ready for you. I'm really hungry, but I'm getting myself ready for you. Check, please. And it would usually get some sort of a giggle in response. My old friend and mentor, Roger Sturdivant, gave me that song way back when I was first starting out. And he came up with the idea of asking for the check at the very end. I forgot how much breath it takes to sing. Sorry, kids. I know I'm asking you to, like, jump and run all over the room and sing at the same time. That's hard. We are athletes, right? And this is an athlete that hasn't been in training in a while. So, moving on to the next one. This is from... this is one of my, actually, it is one of my favorite songs. It's, It's a very moving Candor and Ed piece from a musical called The Happy Time, which was a big vehicle for Robert Goulet back in the 1960s on Broadway. It's a sweet and stirring and melancholy piece. So something that we're all sort of dealing with right now as a community, as a nation, as a globe. So this is time for reflection. I don't remember you. I don't remember you. I don't recall a single thing we used to say or do. What dancing in the park? What laughter in the dark? What smoldering fireplace that lit your face with every spark? And if I left you once before, somehow I can't recall it anymore. That was another girl. You're not at all like her. Though for an instant, when you touched me, I believed you were. But I was wrong. This moment is new. Because I can't, I won't, I don't remember you. That was another time. Another time and place. Although you bear a faint resemblance, you're another face. Yes, I was wrong. This moment is new. Because I can't, I won't, I don't remember. It's actually really a lesson for me to put these songs back on in remembering that in a self-assuring way, I do practice what I preach as a teacher. So it's a relief to go, yep, that's what I convey in class and that's what I'm trying to get students to do and successfully. I have to say that in this time of quarantine and dealing and seeing my students only in this online basis, it is hard to look at these boxes all day long. Thankfully, I don't have a class size more than 16 this semester, but as hard as it is to focus each on every one of those squares and make sure everybody's getting some much needed attention and teaching, I am still so grateful to see them. These students, these BFA students get me through the day, they get me through the week. Sometimes our classes dissolve into discussions about things other than theater, which is really, really healthy. And I miss them terribly. All of you, any of you BFAs watching, I do miss you. And this is hard for all of us, but if we can still connect through song, through humor and comedy, through funny memes, keep it going. Let's make the world sing and let's make the world feel that we're still out there to provide entertainment, whatever that means, whether it's, like I said, with I can't remember you, or I don't remember you, if it's reflective, or if it's a funny moment. You know, I had a moment where I was going to come on and do a whole bunch of impersonations, but, you know, my impersonations are great when I'm in the car or when I'm one-on-one, but the minute I feel like there's some of you out there watching, I don't know. I need more time with it, but I'm working on them. So anyway, I think this next and last tune, I'm trying to work up to it, and I hope I'm not cutting time off short. I didn't know that this time was going to go on longer than I thought. It's okay. It's cool. The last Broadway show I ever did was Thoroughly Modern Millie. We closed in 2004 after a really nice run. I got to work with some fantastic people, and it was during that point that I was starting to look at what my life would be as a director. And I had wonderful opportunities in my career as an actor to work with some fantastic directors. The director for Thoroughly Modern Millie was Michael Mayer, who would also direct American Idiot and Spring Awakening. He's profoundly talented. But it was watching him work with the actors that really inspired me to start looking at this as a career path for myself. So while I didn't pursue many other Broadway shows after Thoroughly Modern Millie, I certainly started to look in my directing career. And so I was very happy to be part of that show. I was a little old to play Jimmy Smith, but it was a big theater. I was 20 pounds lighter. I didn't have any gray hair at the time, so I think I fit in quite well. But I had the time of my life in that show. I was an understudy. I was in the ensemble. I played all sorts of bit little parts throughout the show. It was great fun. And more often than not, I was going on for Jimmy Smith, which is why I wanted to be in the show. And once the show closed, they gave me the role on the national tour for a while. And that was kind of a dream come true. So it was a great way to like have my last Broadway experience, to do everything I wanted to do in a show. I tap danced. I played the secondary lead. I got the next to last curtain call. That was such a thrill. So, and really the most amazing part was getting to sing this song, which Janine Tesori and Dick Scanlon wrote for the role of Jimmy when he is starting to fall in love with Millie. But the conflict is that he doesn't want to fall in love with Millie. He still wants to be this playboy. But we all know it's theater and it's a musical. So what's going to win? The heart. So this is What Do I Need With Love from Thoroughly Modern Millie. Now, folks, it's been a while. Oh, the places I would like to show you, although I hardly know you, I've a funny feeling we'd make a perfect pair. All the sights I want to see you seeing, the nights of you and me. Wait a minute. Just a minute. No, 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 no! I'm a joke with just one aim. Every night to date a different dame. Call each one of them the same pet name. Hey, baby. In a row I have my ducks. Loads of gals to give me loads of yucks. Leave the coon to the other clucks. I don't mean maybe. Got it good. What do I need with love? Always practice what I preach. Keep temptation as easy reach. Stick to dolls and watch the hair and bleach. I'm happy. Come and go the way I choose. Never gonna sing the tied down blues. Other guys would kill to fill my shoes. No wing clipped sappy. Got it good. What do I need with love? That was a near miss. Talk about a close shave. Flirted with disaster. There must be someone up there watching over me. Talk about a four-leaf clover. Me, Peter Rabbit's missing footsie. Means I roll without a tootsie. Got it good. What do I need with love? I got it good. What do I need with love? Skip the vows and all that rot. Tell the minister that I do not. Bright and breezy as the birds and bees is the free and easy is the life I got. Without her. Although I hardly know you. What do I need with love? I got it good. Got it good, but now I got it bad. Whew. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for letting me open my audition book and all those moths and things fly out of it, and the moths fly out of my vocal cords. I want to extend a huge thanks to Ray Fellman, who provided the accompaniment for that. A dear friend and a wonderful music director. And I also want to give a huge thank you to all of the healthcare workers out there who are risking lots to make sure that most of us, the rest of us, stay healthy. So Thank you, Anna. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for having me tonight. This has been so much fun, and I feel like, whew, I got something out. Everybody, please wash your hands and stay safe. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much, Richard. That was so uplifting. I loved it. If you're just tuning in, this is Thursdays at Home. Welcome. The student interns at the Arts and Humanities Council are sharing our perspectives on the arts and culture and life during the COVID-19 crisis. Find our reflections and recommendations at the link in the comments. Our final guest this evening is Professor Ross Gay. Ross is an award-winning poet, essayist, and professor of English at Indiana University. He will be reading a poem from his collection, Catalog of Unabashed Gratitude. Take it away, Ross.
Hey, everyone. Anna, it's good to see you all. I'm glad to be with you. I'm going to read you a few poems. I'm just glad to get to share with you all. This is a poem called To the Fig Tree on 9th and Christian Street. And you know, the poem kind of tells a story of basically coming upon this moment in Philadelphia on a street I used to walk along a lot, where there was a fig tree so laden with fruit that it was staining the sidewalk. To the fig tree on 9th and Christian. Tumbling through the city in my mind without once looking up, the racket and the lugwork probably rehearsing some stupid thing I said or did, some crime or other. The city, they say, is a lonely place until, yes, the sound of sweeping. And a woman, yes, with a broom, beneath which you are now too, the canopy of a fig, its arms pulling the September sun to it. And she has a hose too, and she works hard, rinsing and scrubbing the walk, lest some poor sod slip on the silk of a fig and break his hip and not probably reach over to gobble up the perpetrator. The light catches the veins in her hands when I ask about the tree. They flutter in the air, and she says, take as much as you can, please help me. So I load my pockets and mouth, and she points to the stepladder against the wall to mean more, but I was without a sack, so my meager plunder would have to suffice. And an old woman whom gravity was pulling into the earth loosed one from a low slung branch, and its eye wept like hers, which she dabbed with a kerchief as she cleaved the fig with what remained of her teeth. And soon there were 8 or 9 people gathered beneath the tree, looking into it like a constellation, pointing, do you see it? And I am tall and good for these things. And the bald man even told me so when I grabbed 3 or 4 for him, reaching into the giddy throngs of yellow jackets, sugarstone, which he only pointed to, smiling and rubbing his stomach. I mean, he was really rubbing his stomach, like there was a baby in there. It was hot. His head shone while he offered recipes to the group using words which I couldn't understand. And besides, I was a little tipsy on the dance of the velvety heart rolling in my mouth, pulling me down and down into the oldest countries of my body, where I ate my first fig from the hand of a man who escaped his country by swimming through the night, and maybe never said more than 5 words to me at once, but gave me figs. And a man on his way to work hops twice to reach at last his fig, which he smiles at and calls baby. Come here, baby, he says, and blows a kiss to the tree, which everyone knows cannot grow this far north, being Mediterranean and favoring the rocky, sun-baked soils of Jordan and Sicily. But no one told the fig tree or the immigrants. There is a way the fig tree grows and grows. It seems to want to hold us. Yes, I am anthropomorphizing, goddammit. I have twice in the last 30 seconds rubbed my sweaty form into someone else's sweaty shoulder, gleeful, eating out of each other's hands on Christian Street in Philadelphia, a city like most, which has murdered its own people. This is true. We are feeding each other from a tree at the corner of Christian and Knight. Strangers, maybe never again. I'm going to read a poem called Opera Singer. opera singer. Today my heart is so goddamn fat with grief that I've begun hauling it in a wheelbarrow. No, it's an anvil dragging from my neck as I swim through choppy waters swollen with the putrid corpses of hippos, which means lurking somewhere below is the hungry snout of a croc waiting to spin me into an oblivion worse than this run-on simile, which means only to say, I'm sad. And everyone knows what that means. And in my sadness, I'll walk to a cafe and not see light in the trees or finger the bills in my pocket as I pass the boarded houses on the block. No, I will be slogging through the obscure country of my sadness in all its monotone flourish. And so imagine my surprise when my self-absorption gets usurped by the sound of opera streaming from an open window. And the sun peeks ever so slightly from behind his shawl, and this singing is getting closer so that I can hear the delicately rolled R's like a hummingbird fluttering the tongue, which means a language more beautiful than my own. And I don't recognize the song, though I'm jogging toward it, and can hear the woman's breathing through the record's imperfections. And above me, two bluebirds dive and dart, and a rogue mulberry branch leaning over an abandoned gate drags itself across my face, staining it purple and looking now like a mad warrior of glee and relief, I run down the street. And I forgot to mention the 50 or so kids running behind me, some in diapers, some barefoot, all of them winged and waving their pacifiers and training wheels and nearly trampling me, when in a doorway, I see a woman in slippers and a floral house dress blowing in the warm breeze, who's maybe 70, painting the doorway, and friends, it is not too much to say it was heaven sailing from her mouth. When all the fish in the sea and giraffe saunter and sugar in my tea and the forgotten angles of love and every name of the unborn and dead from this abuelita only glancing at me before turning back to her earnest work of brushstroke and lullaby. And because we all know the tongue's clumsy thudding makes of miracles anecdotes, let me stop here and tell you I said thank you. This is called Sorrow Is Not My Name, and it's after a poem by the wonderful poet Gwendolyn Brooks. Sorrow is not my name. No matter the pull toward brink, no matter the florid deep sleep awaits, there is a time for everything. Look, just this morning, a vulture nodded his red, grizzled head at me, and I looked at him, admiring the sickle of his beak. Then the wind kicked up, and after arranging that good suit of feathers, he up and took off, just like that. And to boot, there are on this planet alone something like 2 million naturally occurring sweet things, some with names so gorgeous as to kick the steel from my knees. Agave, persimmon, stickball, the purple okra I bought for $2 at the market. Think of that. The long night, the skeleton in the mirror, the man behind me on the bus taking notes. Yeah, yeah. But look, my niece is running through a field calling my name. My neighbor sings like an angel, and at the end of my block is a basketball court. I remember. My color's green. I'm spring. And I'm going to read you this little essay from this book called The Book of Delights. Book of Delights is just a book where I wrote an essay a day for a year. I didn't do it every day, but nearly every day for a year, and about something that delighted me. And this was what delighted me this day. It's called Tomato on Board. What you don't know until you carry a tomato seedling through the airport and onto a plane is that carrying a tomato seedling through the airport and onto a plane will make people smile at you almost like you're carrying a baby, a quiet baby. I did not know this until today, carrying my little tomato about 3 or 4 inches high in its 4-inch plastic starter pot, which my friend Michael gave to me, smirking about how I was going to get it home. Something about this at first felt naughty, not comparing a tomato to a baby, but carrying the tomato onto the plane. And so I slid the thing into my bag while going through security, which made them pull the bag for inspection. When the security guy saw it was a tomato, he smiled and said, "I don't know how to check that. Have a good day." But I quickly realized that one of its stems, which I almost wrote as arms, was broken from the jostling, and it only had 4 of them, so I decided I better just carry it out in the open, and the shower of love began. Before boarding the final leg of my flight, one of the workers said, "Nice tomato," which I don't think was a come on. And the flight attendant asked about the tomato at least 5 times, not an exaggeration, every time calling it my tomato. "Where's my tomato? How's my tomato? You didn't lose my tomato, did you?" She even directed me to an open seat in the exit row. "Why don't you guys go sit there and stretch out?" I gathered my things and set the little guy in the window seat next to me so she could look out. When I got my water, I poured some into the little guy's soil. When we got bumpy, I put my hand on the little guy's container, careful not to snap another arm off. And when we landed and the pilot put the brakes on hard, my arm reflexively went across the seat, holding the little guy in place, the way my dad's arm would when he had to brake hard in that car without seat belts to speak of, in one of my very favorite gestures in the Encyclopedia of Human Gestures. And I'm gonna read you one more poem, a short poem. And it's called Overheard. "It's a beautiful day," the small man said from behind me. And I could tell he had a slight limp from the rasp of his boot against the sidewalk. And I was slow to look at him because I've learned to close my ears against the voices of passersby, which is easier than closing them to my own mind. And although he said it, I did not hear it until he said it a second, a third time. But he did. He said, "It's a beautiful day." And something in the way he pointed to the sun unfolding between 2 oaks overhanging a basketball court on 10th Street made me, too, catch hold of that light, opening my hands to the dream of the soon blooming. And never did he say, "Forget the crick in your neck, nor your bloody dreams." He did not say, "Forget the multiple shades of your mother's heartbreak, nor the father in your city kneeling over his bloody child, nor the 5 species of bird this second become memory." No, he said only, "It's a beautiful day." This tiny man limping past me with upturned palms, shaking his head in disbelief. Thank you so much. I hope you're all taking care of yourselves and each other. And I want to dedicate that reading also to my students who I miss so much. Hope you're all doing okay.
Thanks so much for that beautiful reading, Ross. And thank you to all of our talented guests who joined us this week for Thursdays at Home. We're grateful for your time and your willingness to share your craft with our community. And thank you to all of our viewers out there. Although we can't join together in person right now to celebrate the arts and humanities, it has been wonderful to connect with you virtually this evening. We'll be back next week with another Thursdays at Home, 6 p.m. on our Facebook page. Keep an eye out on our social media channels, where we'll be announcing next week's performers soon. And now I'm going to close out the show by reading a poem. This poem is called The Orange, and it's by Wendy Cope. The Orange. At lunchtime, I bought a huge orange. The size of it made us all laugh. I peeled it and shared it with Robert and Dave. They got quarters and I had a half. And that orange, it made me so happy, as ordinary things often do just lately. The shopping, a walk in the park, this is peace and contentment, it's new. The rest of the day was quite easy. I did all the jobs on my list and enjoyed them and had some time over. I love you, I'm glad I exist. So yeah, that was from Wendy Cope, and thanks so much for joining us this evening. It was great. Have a great evening.